Gordon Flake was appointed founding CEO of the Perth USAsia Centre in January 2014. He's authored numerous books and chapters on policy issues in Asia and is a regular contributor to press on Asian issues. He serves on the International Advisory Board of the Kennedy Center. I should mention one of the founding members. He received his BA in Korean and minor in international relations and an MA in international studies here from BYU. He speaks fluent Korean and Laotian. He has had numerous positions as well in Washington, D.C., and worked very closely in the policy world. I can't think of anybody better connected within the worlds within the Beltway as well as within Asian policy. From his current perch in Perth, he brings a unique perspective on trends that are affecting not just global issues, but also Asia. The title of today's presentation, The Emergence of the Indo-Pacific, Understanding the Coming Era in Asia. Please join me in welcoming back to the Kennedy Center, Gordon Flake.
Well, thank you, Corey and Jeff. I'm delighted to be back here. It was over 25 years ago today when I was actually at the Kennedy Center. At that time, it was a master's program without an undergrad program, and all of our classes were held in here with a wonderful round table. So this room holds great import for me, including that map on the wall, and I'm going to be talking a lot about maps and how we think about the world and the construct. I would note that I've had a chance over the last 25 years to come back here on quite a few occasions, but I think this is the first time I've come and I'm not talking about North Korea. And it's a bit of a relief. Could you imagine, you know, a quarter of a century talking about North Korea and the problems never go away? You know, the answers never change, or the lack of answers never change. So it's nice to actually have a fresh perspective and to talk about a bit of a different topic. And this topic, of course, is informed by where I'm living now. You've all heard the axiom that where you stand depends on where you sit. Well, that's something that's become increasingly apparent to me. As Corey mentioned, I spent 25 years in Washington, D.C., working in the public policy think tank community. And 3 years ago, this coming January, my family and I moved to Perth, Australia, which is that, you know, the far, if you don't know, it's that far southwestern tip of Australia. It is actually what we call the antipode, or the antipodes, the furthest point in the planet away from Washington, D.C. In other words, if you dug a hole from Washington, D.C. through the middle of the planet, it would end off about 200 kilometers off the coast of Western Australia. So, you know, in this political year in particular, it is very nice to be on the farthest point in the planet on land away from Washington, D.C. But that has done other things to kind of change my perspective, and hence the topic I've chosen today, which is the emergence of the Indo-Pacific, the coming era in Asia. And that's been largely informed by my shift to Australia. I viewed for 25 years everything really from a Northeast Asia, Korea, Japan, China, where I did most of my work, Washington access. So I spent 25 years, 3 million actual flight miles on Delta Airlines alone, between Washington and Korea, Japan, China, 4 years in actual jet lag, if you put it all together, right? You know, studying Asia. And so my perception of Asia was Northeast Asia. And I think you all know that over the years, what we call this region has shifted dramatically. And it depends on, you know, whether you center your map this way, or most of the maps you've probably seen in U.S. schools have the U.S. in the middle. This one's a little bit different and still. I pulled this one up on purpose because it kind of puts Australia in the middle. It gives you a very different way of looking at the world. For a long time, people talked about it as the Orient, right? You know, and then Asia broadly, or East Asia. You know, when we talked about East Asia, we were really talking about China, Korea, Japan. And then, you know, you tack on Southeast Asia sometimes. In the last 15 years in Washington, D.C., kind of the favored term was the Asia Pacific, because it implied, you know, not, if you think about economic developments in the region, you know, in 1993, the launching of the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation Agreement, APEC, you know, that involved the Asia-Pacific and involved countries from South America as well. If you think of the East Asia Summit and you think of a lot of the other initiatives, it just became kind of de vogue to talk about, you know, we're not talking just about Asia. We're talking about Asia and our naval presence and our security presence in the region at large. But in that context, if you're an Australian, Asia-Pacific puts Australia out of sight, out of mind, kind of down at the very bottom in the process, right? The Australians began using a term called the Indo-Pacific, which is the merging of the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Ocean. And I heard this term beginning 5-6 years ago when I was in Washington, D.C. And if I'm completely candid, I used to make fun of people who use that term, right? Because from a Washington perspective, the Indo-Pacific had no explanatory power. It was silly because, you take the 27 riparian countries that border the Indian Ocean, and you tack them on to the 22 riparian countries that kind of border the Pacific, and all of a sudden you've got two-thirds of the world. It's such a big grouping. Why don't you just do the UN, right? Why would you bother to think of anything other than the way we did organizationally in Washington with the Atlantic Command and the Pacific Command, and the African Command, the Central Command, et cetera, in those regards? It just didn't make sense to me. But now that we have moved to Australia, everything I do at the Perth USAsia Centre that I run, I brand Indo-Pacific, the Indo-Pacific Strategy Program, the Indo-Pacific Energy Dialogue. If we were having children, I'd name one of my children Indo-Pacific. I've got a son here. We made him get an Indo-Pacific tattoo, as it works out. From an Australian perspective, as you might understand it, you're here. We're living in Perth. We are what we call ourselves Australia's Indian Ocean capital, and it's all about the diagonal. It's all about the interaction between the Pacific Ocean and these countries that border it and the emergence of this area right here, in the Indian Ocean. Now, here I'll give you an interesting caveat. There are also a number of organizations that center around the Indian Ocean of which I have very little interest. There's the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium. There's the Indian Ocean Rim Association. If you look at the countries that border the Indian Ocean, Australia, Indonesia, you go up to Burma, Singapore, India, Pakistan, and then the African countries right here. Think about it. Which of those countries has any real capacity to project into the Indian Ocean, to do anything in there? We know there's a lot of countries playing in this space right here, and we can talk about the South China Seas and all the countries that are playing there, right? You may recall the downing of MH370 that took place in 2014. During that year, my father, who lives in Arizona, every time the news would come on, it would mention Perth, Australia, and my dad would call me up. Perth was on the news again today because it was a rare moment in the sun. Because what happened was, as they were looking for MH370 lost somewhere in the Indian Ocean, there was nowhere else that had the naval capacity, the air capacity, the organizational capacity to host it. So every day or every week when I'd fly in or out of Perth, you would see Chinese Air Force planes, American Air Force planes, Singaporean Air Force planes, Malaysian Air Force planes, all on our airport and in our naval bases all going out as part of that search because they had the capacity to reach out to and project themselves into the Indo-Pacific. So the reason I mention that is the Indian Ocean as an organization construct, it's interesting. It's a good confidence-building measure, but it's something that is time has not yet come. To me, that's almost as helpful as talking about a South Atlantic Association. If you think about a South Atlantic organization and all the countries that border, this gives you a better sense of it here, right? Look at the countries that border the South Atlantic. Would you want to have a grouping of that group? Would it make sense to try to tie together Brazil with Namibia? It doesn't make a lot of sense in terms of regimes or countries that have a capacity to actually do something together. So right now, the Indian Ocean groupings, they do some useful work on oceans, on fisheries, on climate change discussions, but in terms of capacity, there's very little there. Now, to detour back then, or to return back to the broader discussion, for me, when I talk about Indo-Pacific, what I'm fundamentally talking about is how do you incorporate India into the Asia-Pacific? Now, why would you want to incorporate India into the Asia Pacific? There's one word, China, right? So for all the other countries in the Asia Pacific who are relatively small compared to an increasingly large and powerful and influential China, you're a little bit worried about how much you can trust the United States to kind of to counterbalance China, to hedge against that. And so as many partners that you can have that are like-minded when it comes to governance and rules of the road and security and economic systems, the better. And India, for all of its false starts in the past, has increasingly been seen as a future power. It has now already got 1.2 something billion people. By 2025, is anticipated to surpass China in terms of being the most populous country in the world. For the last 2 years in a row, its economic growth rate, again, from a very low base, has surpassed China. And so, again, while today you compare the two countries, there's really no comparison at all. India's got a lot of the difficulties that come with both its history and its system. But if you're thinking about the future, there's a tremendous amount of interest in how do you incorporate India into this region as a counterbalance, as a hedge. So in 2014, with new governments in Tokyo, in India, and in Australia, it was no surprise that the first two foreign visits that then Prime Minister Abbott in Canberra made were to Tokyo and to Delhi. It was no surprise that the first two visits made by Prime Minister Modi were to Tokyo and to Canberra, and the first two visits made by Prime Minister Abe were to Canberra and to Delhi. So there's a real interest in these three here. And again, not really about containing China. Again, we can have a longer conversation of that. We have got a real expert here on that in Eric Heyer. But you know, it's not about containing China, but it is about how do you react to it? How do you hedge against its growth? How do you understand, you know, what your interests are in the region writ large? So the Indo-Pacific as a construct is in part about how countries in the region like to think about who's in the club. And I'll give you a couple of recent examples. We have now the G20. The G20, when it comes to global economic infrastructure, has largely become the go-to body for having discussions primarily on economic issues, right? India's inclusion into that, Indonesia's inclusion into that, has really given rise to this notion that somehow there is no hard, fast border right here, that if you really want to talk seriously about the region, you have to include it. Another one, the East Asia Summit, which has become next to APEC, the biggest leaders gathering in the region, right? Again, India is involved in the East Asia Summit, as is Indonesia, et cetera. So it's part about this diagonal going through here. Now, on top of that, if you move beyond just organizations, you start thinking about trade, think about where the energy flows in the region go from. They all go mostly from the Middle East, through the Indian Ocean, up through the Straits of Malacca, or actually down through the Straits of Malacca and up through here, up into China, Korea, Japan, where they're going. Even those coming out of Australia, and again, I'll throw a little factoid here you may not know, Australia has been the recipient over the last 10 years of massive amounts of investment, primarily from American firms, Conoco, Chevron, et cetera. And they just this year started their first exports of LNG. But by most estimates, by the year 2020, Australia will be the world's largest exporter of LNG. More than Qatar, more than the United Arab Emirates. But even then, this is the Indian Ocean. All of those go still through the Indian Ocean up into the Asia Pacific. So again, once again, the notion economically of a dividing line doesn't make sense. Can you provide security for Asia Pacific, sea lanes of communication, transportation, trade lanes, without thinking about the Indian Ocean? No, you can't, right? Yeah, they don't stop there. Now, the third thing I'll note is that if you think about this from a Chinese perspective as well, the Chinese have been pushing for a long time, and again, Professor Heyer can comment in greater detail on this, what they call the Belt Road Initiative, which earlier on was phrased the One Belt, One Road, and the Chinese tried to take that cat and put it back in the bag, but it's out there. Now, most analysts call it OBOR. They like it acronyms, One Belt, One Road. But it's not just one belt, and it's not just one road. It's the Belt Road Initiative for the Chinese. And I actually think of the Belt Road Initiative of the Chinese as the Indo-Pacific with Chinese characteristics, right? Yeah, it's basically about how the Chinese think about how their future is not just this way either, right? They're really interested in the maritime superhighway coming down through this area. And, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank they put forward is really all about how do you begin to invest and to move in this direction. Now, the final thing I want to dwell on in terms of real content is how understanding that makes a difference for where you put your priorities, both academically, economically, and in a security perspective, right? So why do maps matter? I actually, when I was at BYU, as part of the Kennedy Center program, technically it was an international studies master's degree with an Asian studies focus. And yet, in that Asian studies focus, I learned almost nothing about Southeast Asia, right? It was China, Korea, Japan, and India, but not modern India, ancient India, right? Nothing about new India. And Southeast Asia, maybe some shadow puppets from Indonesia or something, right? But let me help you kind of understand this a little bit better, right? My theory, and again, this is self-serving since I'm living in Perth right now, is that for my 25 years of my professional career to date, unquestionably, the defining development of that era was the economic growth of China. That changed everything. And that really has been the defining development of my entire professional career. But if I were to ask you, you know, where you're sitting where I was 25 years ago, what will be the defining development of your first 25 years of your professional career? Will it be the growth of China? No. China's going to be big. It's going to be very powerful. You know, and its influence is going to be felt throughout the region. But its growth will no longer be the defining development of that era. If China stumbles and dissolves or has in some type of instability, that well could become the defining development of the era. That would be big. That would be cataclysmic. But if everything goes the way we hope it goes, the defining development of the next 25 years, I posit, is going to be the southwestern shift of the economic center of gravity in the region. And let me help you understand that. China has 1.3 billion people. Now collectively, ASEAN, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, has about 600, almost 650 million people. You know, by the year 2025, ASEAN will be about 800 million people. Now, ASEAN is diverse. You've got everything from Burma to Cambodia to Laos to Brunei. And, you know, it's really not well organized. We can talk more about ASEAN and question answers if you want to. But having said that, this may shock you. From 2013 till today, for the last 3 years, ASEAN has attracted more inward foreign direct investment than China. And China's economy is four times bigger than ASEAN. Its population is twice as big. So this gives you a sense of kind of where that is shifting. Now, to be fair, a good chunk of that money is coming from China, right? In terms of they're pushing to that development. That's part of that, what I mean, Indo-Pacific with Chinese characteristics. On top of that, again, you think of India, and again, they've had many false dawns, right? But you know, even at kind of baseline projections, you've got a tremendous potential coming there. So I thought something really interesting came out just this week. The Wall Street Journal did an interview with Tsai Ing-wen, who is soon to be inaugurated as the president of Taiwan. If you look in the Wall Street Journal today, last week? I've been on vacations in March. Last March.
This year.
So right before inauguration, sorry. It was the Wall Street Journal article this week from her inauguration, right? And she had a lot of statements about not being bullied by China. But one of the things that she said this week in the interview with the Wall Street Journal, this is the one that came out today, was that for the prosperity of Taiwan, Taiwan needed to invest more in, Southeast Asia and less in China, right? So you think about this as a country that, the whole one China policy, their focus is that we need to have less dependence on China, and we want to do it where? You're going to move down. And that same discussion takes place in Korea. It takes place in Japan. It certainly takes place in India. And interestingly enough, it takes place within China itself in terms of how you do it. So anyway, in a nutshell, and again, recognizing this is a bit self-serving, people ask me, why in the world, after 25 years, did you move from Washington, D.C., the center of the universe when it comes to foreign policy and trade and security and geostrategic, geoeconomic thought, and move to Perth, the farthest point away? And my joke is that I consider myself to be the physical manifestation of the U.S. rebalance towards Asia. So you may be familiar with the Obama administration pivot, right? We're pivoting towards Asia. The interesting thing about the pivot, it wasn't just a pivot towards Asia away from Europe. It was a pivot within Asia towards Southeast Asia. It was a recognition of the increasing importance of that region and an articulated desire to put a higher priority on that region of the world, right? So if you're now Gordon Flake, again, in a self-serving way, and you're sitting here on Australia's Indian Ocean capital, and you're closer to Singapore than you are to Sydney, and you're closer to Jakarta than you are to Canberra, and you're looking at the southwestern shift, my view is that for the next 25 years, living in a place with beautiful beaches, clean air, world-class universities, free press, and direct flights to all these countries, and I'm not dealing with the traffic of Jakarta, the pollution of Beijing, the humidity of Singapore, but I'm living in this environment, it's a pretty sweet spot to spend the next 25 years looking at the world. Now, there are obviously, beyond my own self-serving interests, I think some real trends that are useful to help understanding where we should be putting our priorities, both academically, economically, and in a security sense. And I would just highlight just two or three of those and then stop. You're all very familiar with what's going on in the South China Seas. It's in the media on a daily basis. Indonesia just yesterday or day before yesterday conducted the largest ever Air Force exercises in the South China Seas. The Philippines are a very different case right now. We can go to that if you're interested too. But all of those constructs, again, put that region right there in that in the center point, the fulcrum point of the Indo-Pacific, right? Right there in the middle of the diagonals, it makes sense. And so my hope in my remarks today is that I would give each of you a chance to kind of think a little bit differently about how you see Asia, how you see the region, and how you see how things might develop in the next 25 years. So I'll stop my remarks there and look forward to kind of having a broad conversation about any of a range of issues that you might want to cover. So. Or corrections from my academic colleagues who might have a different point of view.
All right, so we have a good amount of time for questions, so we're looking forward to taking the opportunity to focus in on this. Please come up to the mic, tell us your name, what you're studying, and time is now yours to ask questions.
So no questions is a clear indication of two things. One, I explain things too well. Or the other is probably more likely is that it was so obfuscated that you couldn't understand it at all. There's no questions that come out of it. So,
well, while you're thinking, can you talk a little bit more about the idea of China's view of the Indo-Pacific and how is China? There have been reports of small Chinese investments throughout the area, but also large Chinese investments in places in Africa.
What is the Chinese view of the Indo side of that, and how are they thinking about it strategically?
So the Chinese don't use the term nearly as much as the Southeast Asians do. And candidly, this term, and I should have talked a little bit more about this, was Australian in its origin. So again, there's a reason that I, sitting in Australia, am a fan of it. In fact, it was first used in an official construct by the then Minister of Foreign Affairs, Stephen Smith. Stephen Smith was a Minister of Foreign Affairs and then Minister of Defense, and he happens to be from Western Australia, and he's now in my office, serves as a senior fellow in my center and on my board of directors, and so I am influenced deeply by him. But what happened was his secretary at the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade was a fellow named Peter Varghese, who had just returned from being ambassador to India, and he thought that Australia really needed to rethink how it viewed the region. And it was his effort to try to bring India into that discussion that he began to push this construct. But beginning with Stephen Smith, which has been 5 years ago now, every foreign minister in Australia has used that term in all their official white papers and documents, and likewise now the defense minister. So this has become a construct which is deeply ensconced in how Australia views the world. And again, for Australia, instead of being out of sight, out of mind at the bottom, it puts you at the middle, and it gives you a better sense for its reach. Now, that said, for the average Australian, too, all of Western Australia, right here, Western Australia is about basically the size of the one state is the size of the third of the United States. I mean, it's four times larger than Texas, to put it in context, which is something that's really great to lord of the Texans. You know, it's our state. We're four times bigger than Texas. But the thing is, there's only 2.6 million people in that entire space. The bulk of the population of Australia remains over here in Adelaide, Melbourne, Sydney, Canberra, up in Brisbane, in this small area right here. And their orientation, candidly, is not very Indo-Pacific yet. It's still very much Asia-Pacific. And if anything, they think they're part of California. They haven't quite made that jump yet. Whereas where I live, and the reason my center was centered here, Western Australia is actually much more deeply integrated into the Indo-Pacific, into the Asia-Pacific, than it is into the rest of Australia. And as a result, there's a unique perspective there that kind of could push that perspective. So that's kind of where the origin of that came from. But you'll find now that American officials, just out of having done some research, whenever they speak to Australians, Americans will use the term Indo-Pacific a lot. And it's gaining increasing traction in Washington because this is a construct the U.S. likes. Because the U.S., obviously having the ability to project into both oceans, sees some real utility in that. And if there's any country that's a cheerleader for a rising Indian role in the region is the United States. So I predict this is a term you're going to hear a lot more, particularly coming out of the United States.
Great. Come up to the mic. Go ahead.
My name is Garrett Christensen. I'm a mechanical engineering major, but I'm also interested in going into international business and whatnot. I noticed you talked a lot about kind of the economic shift of the world, like kind of it's going more south and to the Indo-Pacific. What's your suggestions as far as like the next 25, 30 years for business and like globalization and outsourcing and stuff like that?
Look, these are much bigger pictures than I'm actually capable of really wrestling with seriously. So I know kind of what I see and consume in the news the same as you. There is cause for concern. If you look at, you know, trends within democracies globally in terms of how they think about internationalization, how they think about free trade. So if you look at the Brexit vote, you look at what's happening in the U.S. elections here, the fact that, you know, we've now got both candidates opposing the Trans-Pacific Partnership. There is cause for some concern. On the flip side of it, you know, if you look at these countries in this region in particular that have seen, you know, people don't realize what a dramatic impact, you know, economic integration has had on the Asia Pacific. And I can't remember the exact figures, but, you know, poverty, I mean, extreme poverty within the Asia Pacific has gone from something like in 1960, 60% of the population down to less than 10%, you know, in this entire region. So this region as a whole has benefited tremendously from integration, trade, economic, you know, exchanges and expansion between countries. If you look at Southeast Asia in particular right now, there are countries that get it and there's countries that don't. And there's a remarkable divide between them. 15 years ago, when Laos, Cambodia, Vietnam, and Myanmar joined ASEAN, they were all considered to be basically, you know, charity cases. We're going to let you in, even though you're not, you know, you're not a kind of a developing, rising economy like Thailand and Indonesia and Malaysia and these other countries were. Right now, if you ask me, if there's one country in the world that I find fascinating, it's Vietnam. You know, Vietnam is interesting enough. You know, they joined the Trans-Pacific Partnership trade negotiations. They're hungry. They're young. They, like Korea did in decades in the past, using joining the OECD or its free trade agreement in the United States, they're using the TPP to force, you know, domestic economic changes so they can become more competitive. And those changes, particularly those involved in these trade agreements, all make it a better environment for doing business. And so there are these competing trends, right? There are positive things being done. There are some real serious concerns about the growing gap between the, you know, ability of policymakers and big business, the elite, so to speak, and the ability to communicate that to the broader public when it comes to, you know, public support for these types of agreements. And the last point I'll make on that is that one of the underlying problems of this, and I presume you see it here in Provo as well, but my guess would be less than in most places, is that the benefits of global trade, the benefits of international business are undeniable. They're tremendous, right? But they are extremely diversely shared throughout societies. And so everybody in this room benefits from cheap prices at Walmart, right? You benefit tremendously from it. It's the equivalent for the average person in America, something like a $4,500 tax cut that you get in reduced prices every year. You save that much money because of the benefits of trade, right? But nobody thinks about it that way. And because those benefits are shared so diversely, nobody gets really worked up about it, right? Whereas if you are in an industry and you think the Chinese have taken your job, when it's almost certainly to have been automation, not the Chinese, right? You're going to feel that intensely and personally, and as a result, the opponents of trade and globalization and national business are going to be a lot more vocal and a lot more motivated than the broad-based, you know, beneficiaries of that thing. And that's something we have to deal with more broadly. So probably a little bit more philosophical than you wanted, but hopefully it's helpful.
Thank you.
My name's Michael Hansen. You mentioned that a lot of the Southeastern Asian countries and India are trying to get away from dependency on China's help economy. I was just wondering if you could expand a little bit more on the relationship or how those countries kind of view China, because we know our point of view, but I don't think very often we hear about how India and these countries view China and their relationship.
So one of the ways to answer that question is to go back to March, April of 2009, when the Obama administration was just coming in. Before anybody had articulated a rebalance towards Asia, a pivot towards Asia. And in April of 2009, then Secretary of State Hillary Clinton went with Kurt Campbell, her Assistant Secretary of State, and they toured the region, almost every country there. And they came back just stunned because everyone had the same message. We want you here. We need you here. We need a greater presence. We're really concerned about China. Because really what had happened was during the Iraq War period, you know, the Chinese were eating the Americans' lunch, right? Because they had, you know, really skilled diplomats. They were out paying the time, pounding the shoe leather, investing in these relationships throughout the entire region. And the Americans were just terrorism, you know? Hu Jintao spent 21 days on a trip through Australia. You know, George Bush spent 18 hours, and he talked about terrorism, right? And as a result, there was just this kind of growing worry that we're increasingly dependent on China. We need a counterbalance. And so the Chinese view the American pivot towards Asia, the rebalance towards Asia, as an American containment interfering in their region. I personally view that as an American reaction. It's a reaction to every other country in the region saying, get back here, we need you here, and more importantly, we need you to articulate that you're here, just to reassure us and our publics, you know, in that process, because we're worried, right? And the truth is, China has a really hard time understanding that. Now, everybody, I'm delving into a very different subject here right now, but you know, you've probably seen a lot of articles and a lot of writing about Japan's history problems. You know, and again, when it comes to historical legacies and dealing with your history, there's no question Japan and every country has some problems. But if you were to ask me, the country that has the biggest history problem is China. Because you've got two generations now that have no understanding of China's historical relationships with its neighbors other than to think that China is a benign power that has never interfered in the foreign, the domestic policies of any other countries. And as a result, when the Filipinos or the Vietnamese or the Mongolians or the Koreans say, we're bored here, the only way the Chinese can process that is to say, it must be those Americans that have put them up to it. They're stirring up trouble here. They can't conceptualize why any country in the region would be resistant when they've been such a benign power historically, because China never, they were an inward-looking power. They never bothered other countries. They never invaded Vietnam in 1979. They don't understand that in that context. And so that impacts it. But that said, it's not a black and white issue. None of these countries want, you know, the U.S. over China. Almost every one of these countries deal with this tension of an economic dependence on China, which ironically is actually still tied into U.S. as the ultimate market, a final destination, right? But a dependence upon the U.S. for security. And so Australia has the same issue, Korea has the same issue, the Philippines have the same issue. You know, how do you balance this? So you want options, you want choices, you want hedges, but you don't want conflict. And so for all the shrill voices you hear coming out of Washington, D.C., why isn't the U.S. being tougher in the South China Seas? Why didn't we stop them from building the island, right? Well, because our partners in the region don't want us to, right? They're not supportive of it. They're not unified because it's a tension between a little bit of both. And it makes it complex, but that's the real world of foreign policy.
My name is Eric Schaub. I'm a political science major. I was wondering if maybe you could comment on the fact that this region is incredibly diverse in its religious environment and what that kind of matters in the case of like Indonesia and Malaysia being Muslim and India being Hindu and Christianity, et cetera, like what that, how that affects these relationships between these countries.
It is definitely a complicating factor. But like everything else, compared to the Middle East, it's a lot better. You know, as someone who really, you know, banged my head against the wall for a quarter of a century working in North Korea, I could always say, well, at least I'm not a Middle East specialist, right? Because it kind of puts things in contrast. There's no question that Southeast Asia is deeply concerned about Islamic extremism. You know, interestingly enough, if you break it down on a per capita basis, you know, the Indonesians are the least, you know, extreme population of Muslims anywhere in the world, right? You know, so for example, about 2 years ago when they were really concerned about foreign fighters in ISIL, you know, there was a breakdown of you know, how many came from Australia, how many came from Malaysia, how many came from Indonesia, yeah, which is fine. But when you broke it down on a per capita, let alone per capita Muslim basis, you know, Indonesia had the lowest percentage of radicalized individuals of any country in the world, right? So the real question would be, why is Indonesia sending so few? Why are so few radicalized? Now, that said, there are real concerns as people who have gone into the theater in the Middle East been involved with ISIS or ISIL, and they come home and they do radicalize, and there are very serious security concerns that all the regions kind of work together. And that said, I don't think that has been a major issue within ASEAN. ASEAN has been at its core driven by, economic integration. It really has resisted strongly a core central administrative or political or security organization. You have some spin-offs, the ASEAN Regional Forum, other things that do things a little bit differently, but they're deeply resistant to that. Interesting question. I have not seen evidence of, or I can't point to evidence of, areas where that has been the primary issue in terms of how they work together, because ASEAN itself celebrates its diversity, both in terms of history, religion, background. And I'll just point to one thing. If you're interested in that question more broadly, there's an interesting middle power grouping within the G20 called MICTA. Mexico, Indonesia, Korea, Turkey, Australia. That's the cause of that acronym. And they've actually gotten together at a foreign minister's level 7 times now, entered joint statements. These are all middle power countries, all of them with the G20. But if you think about it, Mexico, predominantly Catholic, Turkey, Indonesia, predominantly Muslim, Korea, more Christian than anything, but also Buddhist in that mix. Australia, more atheist than anything, but you put it in that mix. It's a very interesting grouping with a lot of diverse things. And that, to be honest, that diversity is seen as part of their strength, because if these countries with that diverse background and religion and economic status and regional positioning can agree on something, there is an influential power that you wouldn't gain from having a sub-regional bloc or a group like the G7 or G8 coming together on that. Good question. I'm not well-versed enough to know too much more, but hopefully that helps you think about it a little bit. So,
thank you.
Hi, my name's Dylan Bay, doing chemical engineering. I was wondering, so recently in our election season, of course, there's been, and in past years, there's been kind of a resurgence of a sort of, if not isolationist, then non-interventionist schools of thought on, both Republicans, Libertarians, Democrats. And I was wondering if America were to pursue sort of a strongly non-interventionist policy. Obviously, this is kind of a different conversation than the Middle East, of course. But do you feel like this would be almost cataclysmic for the region and really bad? Or do you feel like it would be helpful, if the Americans were to kind of leave them on their own and let them develop their own, voice in the matter?
My own opinion aside, the region feels it would be cataclysmic. And so going back to what happened in 2008, where already there was an isolationist trend, and I would argue that the Obama administration is a manifestation of that isolationist trend, right? I mean, the American public is war-weary. For all that John McCain and others might want to castigate the president for not getting back more involved in Libya or more involved in Syria, the Senate would not vote for it. the Congress was not ready to support it. And so it's easy for hawks to kind of claim it, but the country as a whole is war-weary, and so we actually have seen an isolationist trend. The countries within the region all, I think, to a country, want to see, with the exception of China, want to see a more proactive, more active U.S. role in the region, because the U.S. has seen, and candidly has been, in addition to bad things we've done, right? I mean, the good thing I've always found pride in our country is the country that's always the most critical of the United States is the United States, right? We're pretty open about our dirty laundry in terms of what we've done in Abu Ghraib or what we did in Vietnam or what mistakes we made in the Philippines. Those are pretty well-known facts, right? They're out there. But as a whole, the countries in the region kind of want the United States there as an enforcer of global standards and norms, the rules of the road. And so the reason why countries as diverse as Brunei and Malaysia and Vietnam signed into the TPP is because they want those rules of the road laid down. So a part of this discussion really is, and you're going to hear this a lot in the South China Sea, is this debate over do we follow the liberal post-World War II, international order, or do we go back to might versus right? And you'll hear some Chinese talk about the South China Sea. Well, you had the Monroe Doctrine, right? You certainly did that in Central America. Well, we did. There's no question about that. I don't think anybody denied that. But that might versus makes right kind of mentality is what led to World War I, and it's what led to World War II, and it's what the international community intended to repudiate when they came up with the UN, and again, imperfect though it may be, this, you know, the liberal international order. One of the real questions about South China Seas today is it going to be determined based on international tribunals and judgments, or is it going to be based on who's bigger and who's stronger? And every country in the region individually is certainly weaker than China. And as a result, the more that they can have other partners to help balance that and make it a little bit more of a balanced kind of debate, the better. Now, I'll go one step further. I was in Washington probably 3 weeks ago now and met with the Australian ambassador to the United States, and he gave the most impassioned plea I have ever heard for an American presence in the region. He basically tied it back to Woodrow Wilson's 19 points, right? He says the American presence in the region is based on every one of these 19 points. And what happens if the Americans pull out, right? And this is why, to be honest, the entire globe is so freaked out by our election right now. Because, you know, in a nonpartisan environment, I'll say one side of this campaign has set about repudiating on an international state basis almost every one of those 19 points that Wilson set out, right? And so the rest of the world is saying, if America doesn't stand for these, who does, right? What's going to happen? We invest a lot into you. We want more of you. But I've really not seen any indication other than that they want more, not less.
Thank you. Hi. My name is Savannah Hinch. I'm a political science major. And I was wondering what your thoughts were on the new Filipino president and kind of how valid his just his new ideas are and what you think the effects will be in the region.
Well, Duterte is an example that elections have consequences. And to be honest, he is a minor preview of what would happen if we elected President Trump. You know, it really is. I mean, to be honest, he'd be better than Trump, and he's bad, right, in that regard. And so, you know, just someone who, to be honest, just doesn't think, doesn't study, shoots off at his mouth on a regular basis, and yet he's popular with a major segment of the Filipino population. You know, so you know, if you're interested in democracies writ large, there's several trends that have been happening recently where, to be honest, it's worth thinking about how our societies are structured. You know, one would be this question of whether or not we have international plebiscites, you know, referendums on big, complex issues, right? Do you really want to have a national referendum on something like Brexit, right? Well, we know the results of that, right? Does that mean those people were right? The people who are going to get hurt worse by Brexit are the ones who voted for it. All right, go to Colombia, you know, who just repudiated this carefully 6-year negotiated peace deal with the longest running civil war in the world, right, with the FARC guerrillas, right? And it went to a national referendum unadvisedly, and it was turned down. Who's going to get hurt most by that, right? You just think about it. So look at TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Like every trade deal, big, complex, hard to understand, like I was saying earlier, hard to kind of, you know, understand these widely dissipated benefits, which are tremendous in compared to the cost. But, you know, do you put it to a national referendum? So you hear American political scientists say this is why we do not believe in government by referendum, government by opinion poll. This is why we have a representative system of government where we send people we trust, and they are supposed to think through hard issues and make decisions on our behalf, right? But if you think about it, you know, and you take that trend and you put it to what's happened with some individual leaders, mm-hmm. who tend to to govern based on popularity, govern in what can be, you know, a very you know, populist kind of manner, that's dangerous. And so you have a situation where the Philippines, you know, 6 months ago were, you know, the ROC actively courting closer United States cooperation because of the very real threat of China on their territory in the islands. And all of a sudden you get a guy who is just, you know, provoked by a tweet, you know, mad that somebody might dare, you know, criticize his death squad killings of drug smugglers on the streets, and says, well, if the Americans don't give me, I can get it from the Chinese and Russians. And kind of, good luck with that, buddy. But there are consequences. So I don't know. Somebody might be a Filipino specialist here, but I have a hard time finding something good to say about that experience and what's going on in the Philippines right now. And I think it is what I would call a very strong cautionary tale. Unfortunately, the people who are likely to vote for one side of the ticket in this election are not likely to know where the Philippines are. I've never heard about it. So.
Thank you.
Thanks for your questions, and please join me in thanking Gordon Flake.
My pleasure.